Good morning, everyone. I'm so thrilled to finally be here after a whole year of planning and putting together this conference with my co-chairs, the hardworking committee members, and the ABI staff. And I'm delighted to introduce as our first keynote speaker, the always inspiring Hillary Mason. Hillary Mason is the founder of Fast Forward Labs, a New York City-based machine intelligence research company. She's also the data scientist in residence at Accel Partners, and formerly served as the chief scientist at Bitly. Hillary has deep roots in the New York City technology scene, co-founding Hack New York, co-hosting Data Gotham, and participating in the NYC Resistor. Hillary is also an active member of Mayor Bloomberg's Technology and Innovation Advisory Council. Hillary's many honors include earning the Tech Fellows Engineering Leadership Award and being named to Forbes 40 Under 40 list. Hillary also serves as a mentor to accelerators and advisor to several New York City startups. Please join me in welcoming Hillary Mason to the stage.
This is the best room in the world right now. Wow. So good morning, I'm Hillary. I'm gonna talk to you about a couple of things. First, I really wanna say welcome. Welcome to Texas. Thank you, NASA, for this Creative Commons photo. And welcome to all of the friends, colleagues, and other wonderful folks in the audience. So I'm gonna give a talk today speaking from multiple roles. So I am a computer scientist, I'm a data scientist, I'm a software engineer, and I'm also a CEO. And I look like all of those things. And so this talk I'm gonna give today is about machine intelligence, which is an area I'm very enthusiastic about, and also about what it means to be a professional, especially somebody who's a little bit earlier in your career in a world where the technology is changing so quickly. But I want to start by sharing one of my favorite things on the internet with all of you, and this is it. So I'm going to ask, how many people here are Reddit users? Okay, we got maybe some employees over there. Awesome. So I sort of consider Reddit to be the armpit of social media. I mean that in the kindest way, in the sense that it is a place where a lot of really interesting things that you might not have known to expect sort of appear. And by that I mean that some really beautiful things show up, also some really not so beautiful things. But today I want to share with you one of my favorite questions of all time, and that is somebody asking this question. If someone from the 1950s, yes?
Sorry, what if you took your hair and put it behind
my
you?
Hair is ruining the talk.
There you go.
Oh my gosh, these are curly hair girl problems. All right, so if somebody from the 1950s suddenly appeared today, what would be most difficult thing to explain to them about life today? And the answer, the best answer, is this one. I possess a device in my pocket that is capable of accessing the entirety of information known to man. I use it to look at pictures of cats and get in arguments with strangers, right? And this is an example of something that represents to me so clearly that technology is changing very rapidly, but we are not. We as human beings are not. And in fact, I had a wonderful conversation with someone recently where we were talking about some of the ancient Greek plays, and he was bemoaning the fact that these things are written in 500 BC, and we can still read them and still have an emotional response to that same text. And to me, that is amazing, because it says that we as humans, we're still human, we are still the same people. And so now, when we think about machine intelligence, We're thinking about technology. I'm sorry. What am I doing now?
We just want it to be the best it can be. Go ahead, Lee. We're going to quick switch.
Okay. This is not what I planned at all. All right, so back to the talk. What I really want to talk about is, from a technical perspective, machine intelligence, which is really an umbrella term that is emerging over a bunch of things that have existed for a long time, like machine learning, data science, data engineering, product design, user experience design. But this term is emerging now for a bunch of reasons that are actually pretty interesting. And it's because machines are starting to do things that previously we might have thought were the creative domain of the human mind alone. And so here's an example. It's from a paper called StyleNet that came out. And it's showing the Mona Lisa algorithmically reimagined in the style of Picasso, Van Gogh, and Monet, entirely automated. There's a lot of other really cool examples and code available as well, so you can all play with it. And here's another example I always find super amusing and compelling. This is a poem from a Twitter bot called Pentometron that sort of looks at tweets in iambic pentameter and puts it together into an actual sonnet. This is a bot written by Ranjit Bhatnagar, who's an NYC Resistor member. But it's doing something really interesting and creative. And we're seeing this already in the products we use every day. And so these things have already infiltrated our lives. Here are a few examples. So Foursquare is an app from a New York City company. And they've done perhaps one of the best jobs I've ever seen of building an app to collect data and then using that data to build a subsequent version of that app that did things that, because of the data, they could do. And so to give you a specific example, they started with checking in. So you check into a restaurant, and then they took all the data they had about what phones look like from signal strength and whatnot when they check into a specific venue, and they learned about what you like. And now when I walk into a restaurant, it pops up and says, oh, you should get the cheeseburger here because you really like cheeseburgers. It is a really nice use of the right data at the right time to make a good decision. Fantastic data product. Another one I really love is an app called Dark Sky, and this one is remarkable because it was built on top of open government weather data. So you give it your GPS location, it makes a micro forecast for where you are standing right now, and then it tells you if it's going to rain on you. And so I know we have a lot of folks here from California, and I know you don't care at all, but for the rest of us, this is really, really cool. And the last example I wanted to share is a product I think we all use, well, I won't speak for anyone else, I use it all the time, and it's the Google Maps view, and in this case, the traffic is turned on, and I think there's something really remarkable about this product, and I'll give you a moment, just guess what's remarkable. It's so boring. And I mean that with great respect to the people who work on it. What is boring about it is that there is an immense amount of technology behind this product. I'm sure they're doing all sorts of predictions, they're gathering real-time data, they're presenting it, and yet in order to use this product, you pull it out, you put in a destination, you look, green means go, red means don't go, you make a decision, you put it away. You can use the product with absolutely no awareness of the technology that is going on behind the scenes. And to me, that is the most successful data product. And here is the Mona Lisa reimagined in the artistic style of Google Maps, which I'm sharing to illustrate the point that while these algorithms may have some ability to imitate creativity, they have not yet developed wisdom or a real aesthetic sense. And we're starting to see things creep even further down that spectrum from, you know, rules-based and even probabilistic into things that might be considered creative. And there are reasons this is happening now. And the first one is that we can afford the computing power it takes to do this. So this is a photo of ENIAC in the 1940s, was 150 feet long with 20 giant banks of lights. right? We all carry around, in many cases, multiple computers that are so much faster than this. It was not even that long ago. The second reason is that we know what to do with data once we have it. We've developed very robust algorithmic processes in different domains. And it turns out that within a domain, people like to think their data is very unique, but it really isn't. The majority of the data we see from web products is from human behavior inside of that product or maybe in social media. There's certainly healthcare data, bioinformatics data, there's data from sensors and other hardware devices, but within each domain, the data from human behavior is sort of the same. And that is a good thing because it means that what someone has learned in one application can actually transfer to another, so we sort of know what we're doing. And the last reason this can happen now is we actually have data and we're getting access to more and more of it. And so if you are actually at a company and you don't have data, it is always worth going around and knocking on the doors of the people who do. And if you you want a little bit of guidance on how to do that, I usually start by just asking, you know, what data do we have? And then what data should we have? And then what can we do with this data to validate the assumptions we've made about the world or about the product that we can now question in a statistical way now that we've gathered this data? So data is becoming a resource in a bunch of different ways. And the thing that's tying it all together in the context of machine intelligence is that we also have these devices we are carrying around with us that collect, that mediate our communication, and that give us a platform for building these applications such that they can actually interact with us in the course of our daily lives. And I don't think this is going to be limited to merely phones, but also things like wearables, things in our environments, and lots of contextual computing. And so I wanted to share a little bit of a personal story. This is a photo from my office last year. So we had the little bub cat on the wall with the Yule log. It's a great video. It's an hour long. Great sound. And then one of our advisors brought his dog over, and the dog promptly fell asleep in front of the cat. And I was staring at this while trying to write some code. And I shared this story because I wanted to talk a little bit about the day I became convinced that data science was actually interesting. And it was not a story about how I actually solved a real important problem for humanity and saw the impact. It was actually the opposite. It was a day where I was working at a social media company called Bitly, and we had just made some tweaks to the configuration on our Hadoop cluster. And we'd run some small jobs to sort of test that, and we wanted to run something bigger just to make sure everything was working. We hadn't really prepared anything. And so one of my colleagues, Anna Smith, and I did this project where we were like, you know, the internet is made up of cute animals. Let's see whether people click on dogs or cats or turkeys or whatnot. And so we ran this job, and it finished, and we actually got the answer. Which is the cutest animal on the internet. And it occurred to me in that moment that we had just used hours of compute time and a petabyte or so of data to answer the most frivolous question we could possibly think of. And that tells me that we can now play. This technology is so accessible and so cheap that we can play. And if you want the answer, by the way, it is dogs. And this is happening in a bunch of different domains. So if you haven't seen this Tumblr, it is absolutely amazing. It's called We Put a Chip in It, and they sort of someone takes a toaster and puts Wi-Fi in it, and it shows up on this blog because now you've got a Wi-Fi toaster. It's a thing with a chip in it. One of my favorite projects they wrote about is this disco LED dog suit, which was a Kickstarter. And this is awesome, and it is awesome because this technology is so cheap that someone can conceive of this idea and build this ridiculous thing, and now it exists in the world. And when you start to see ridiculous things occurring, you know that something really interesting is there because that technology has become a tool that all of us can use. And we really are just at the beginning, and we're also at the beginning of seeing the impact that our decisions around this technology are going to have in the years to come. And you know, one of the things that I really love about computer science as a field is that it gives you an opportunity to have an outsized impact through the work that you do, which is itself fascinating. And I have touched code that has touched a billion actual people, and I know there are people in this room who can say many more interesting things than that. And so thinking about these things now is really also thinking about that impact we can have. And when we think about that impact, it's always worth understanding that there are cultural consequences we cannot predict. And so in 1999, Sony released this robot dog product called the Aibo. They're pretty cute, and they were certainly way ahead of their time. And they stopped repairing them in 2013, which means that people fell in love with these things, and now they are dying. And now people are having funerals for their robot dogs. And this was a brilliant video series by the New York Times, and I highly recommend it. But the point here is that no engineer, I mean, I can't imagine an engineer on that product could predict that so many years later, people would be having like emotional funerals for their robot dogs. Sometimes the cultural consequences of our technical decisions are just outside of our reach. And none of this is new, and it's always worth understanding our history in order to understand why things are the way they are today, and perhaps to get a glimpse into where they might go. And just to illustrate this point, this is a post from SuperUser, which is the sysadmin Stack Overflow site, where someone is asking, essentially, why is there an A and B in Windows? Like, where did it go? Why do we start at C? Because, you know, if you add other drives, they go D and after. What was that A and B for? And so if you don't know the answer to this, ask someone who's laughing, who's probably also old. It's floppy drives. And this is a photo. I learned two remarkable things about punch cards really recently, but this photo is also worth sharing because this is Susan Elliott, who was fired for her job at IBM in the 60s because she got pregnant. She's a programmer, so she started her own company. And this is also one of the coolest photos, punch cards I could find. So she's a badass, she's got her punch card. Two things about punch cards that that are still affecting the way we program today. One is that first character that's punched out means ignore this line, and that's where the comment character comes from. The second is that punch cards standardized at 80 columns, and so if you're writing a lot of, say, like Fortran 77 code, you're stuck with that. That's where that comes from. Always useful to understand. But it's not enough to talk about technology without talking about being a professional in a world of technologists. And so the second half of this talk, really gonna think about what it means to be a computer scientist in the future and how that is changing. And it really is changing. What it means to be a computer scientist is evolving and growing. And as the technology we work on changes and the place that that technology ends up, the products we build start to have more impact, what it means to be a professional in this world is changing as well. And it's not that it is being taken away, it's that it is an additive thing, sort of a flowering of computational capabilities. And we see this in new job roles being created now. So people have job titles like data scientist. They have job titles like DevOps. They have job titles where they are taking computer science and they are adding something else to it. And this, even if you're in academia, you're not free of this. No matter what discipline you're in, people are now taking the core practice of computer science with them into those disciplines. And you are assumed to have to be proficient in some form of programming and some understanding of algorithms if you want to do the most interesting work in those fields as well. And I'm going to talk a little bit about data science because it's a discipline I understand very well. And when you think about data science, a lot of people think, well, it's a computer scientist who knows statistics, or I've heard it's a statistician who lives on the West Coast. Like a lot of different definitions, but the way I've come to think about it is essentially this. It is a person who in one professional role combines multiple capabilities. So they combine that mathematical and statistics ability with the ability to code, to program, to use technology infrastructure, and in many cases to build and design it as well. And the last bit is communication domain knowledge. It is everything they need to know to go talk to somebody who has a problem, to go away and MacGyver up some analysis with the tech tools they have and the data they have access to go back to that first person and explain the solution to that problem so someone else can make a better decision. And data scientists end up working on problems like analytical problems. They work on building pieces of products. It's a pretty wide and still not well-defined field, but that is what's wonderful about it. And it's just one example of how being a computer scientist is different in 2015 than it was even in 2000. And it's always worth doing the exercise, especially for those of you who are young in your careers, of thinking about what, not just what you want to be in 5 years, because everyone will ask you that in every interview and you're going to bullshit the answer anyway, but to think about what the field might look like in 5 years or 10 years and where you want to be in that future. And so here we have a few examples of people imagining the future. These are French artists in the year 1900 imagining the year 2000. And they go from plausible and done on the left side to like, sort of right in the middle to like not kind of not there on the right side. Because we have here on the left like automated machine agriculture. We have that. In the middle, I'm going to call that Wikipedia. If you can't see it, it's like, you know, little brain wires into kids' brains while this poor one like has to crank the whole system. There is inequality. And then on the right, we sort of have private little aerial firefighting rigs because, you know, you can fly, but your house is still going to burn down because they were imagining this in France in the year 1900. But I'm showing this because it is always useful and fun to think about what the world might look like and how we might get there. And in order to do that, I spend a lot of time thinking about, like, where do the really big, interesting, hard ideas come from? And what does the system look like that's producing them? And we tend to think that the most interesting stuff comes from academia, and this is largely true. There is fantastic research in the academic community, but that is itself driven by a certain set of incentives and challenges that does not always mean that you can work on what is most interesting to you at any given moment. And we think, well, why don't big companies solve all these problems? They've got data, they've got technology, they've got lots of money. But they also have, generally, some business that is succeeding, and if you are doing something different, you're going to encounter a lot of friction. And then we think, well, startups will solve the problem, and that's certainly the mythology in our world right now. But startups are themselves generally inventing a new product. They are also sometimes inventing a new business model. And sometimes they are also, on top of those other two things, inventing a new technology. And doing those three things at the same time is so hard that it is really a very difficult thing to attempt. Instead, we see most startups using commodity technology to create that new product, that new business model. And this means there are really interesting gaps in the world that have yet to be figured out. And that system that we work in is complicated, and it is important to understand that system in order to be able to hack that system. And to find whether you're looking for a job, you want to create an open source project, you want to start a company, to find the little place where your thing will fit in. And in starting a company, I've learned that it is not a naive enterprise, in the sense that, I mean that naively as in not a dependent variable. You are dependent on everything going around you. And when you want to start an organization or a project or a job, you're doing it in a context of colleagues, of a market, of a technology. And so when you're trying to build one of these things, you're trying to do it in such a way that it optimizes around all of those things. And I've been involved in building a nonprofit, and building a company, building a couple of ridiculous side projects, and all of these things succeed not necessarily because of the strength of the project itself, but because of the way it interacts with what is going on in the world around it. And so that's my little bit of the talk for all of you who are looking for your first job. And if you are someday thinking about creating an entity or a new sort of organization, as an engineer, I find it very helpful to think about creating an organization as deploying another type of infrastructure, and a type of infrastructure that you deploy when you have an idea that needs to scale beyond just you. And that's the time and place for creating an organization as an instance of an entity. I'm going to end my talk by talking a bit about my current hack, which is a company I started in June of 2014. And we were trying to be a new method for applied research. And we focus on helping other people identify opportunities through the data they have, the technology that exists, to actually build really interesting and impactful new products and new business ventures. And I'll tell you what that actually means. We basically sit in the middle of three communities where we spend a lot of time doing research and reading papers, and we spend a lot of time talking to people building new products and building startups. And we work with a lot of established companies who have technology, they have data, and they generally have some kind of business in that space. And we sit in the middle, and the team is mostly reformed academic types, sort of like me, so people who like to research and like to build things and also like to talk about them. And this is a good time to be looking into this space. So there are challenges in keeping up with technology and building, not for people in this room, but in general, that pace of technology adoption is speeding up. That means that if you are running a business or a product, it has to evolve just to maintain its current success. You have to invent new things in order to stay relevant. And people look to technology to do that. They look to data to do that. And yet it's still a very hard thing to do. And we don't really have great mechanisms for applied research in our world yet. And so this is what we're doing. I think the biggest opportunities for these products might actually be surprising, because they are at sort of the big companies where they have some data and they have a need. And we spend a lot of time looking at things that are becoming interesting but are not yet commoditized. And there's a formula for doing that that is something that I'm pretty proud of. It's taking an idea that is emerging, a technique, a bit of technology, a way people are solving problems in a product, or a cultural innovation. That is, the idea of being data-driven is an example of a cultural innovation where the math and technology piece is actually trivial. The challenge for implementing something like that is getting people to actually care, right? But we look for things that are emerging but not well understood. And there are lots of reasons why this happens. The first reason is there's actually a theoretical breakthrough. So someone has done some research that has opened up a new way of thinking about a problem. And in my field, that might not even be something that you would call a breakthrough. It might be incremental progress in one area that can actually be applied in another area. So there are multiple ways that these sorts of things happen. And the second thing is a change in the economics of the systems that constrain what you're trying to build. So looking at things like, we can build graphs like this all day, the cost of a hard drive per gigabyte going down linearly. This is a really fun one from the internet somewhere where somebody took a SD card with 128 megabytes on the left side and 128 gigabytes on the right side. But there are plenty of things we'd want to do that are constrained because they are too expensive. We can't afford the machines to do it. We don't have the storage capacity. We don't have enough memory. And so if you monitor those economic conditions, things become possible just because of those changes. The third thing is because a capability becomes a commodity and it becomes something you can build on top of without having to reinvent or re-engineer something. My favorite example of this is the Hadoop open source project, at least for data processing, because this is a project where, you know, Google published the MapReduce paper. If you wanted to actually do this stuff, you had to hire a team of engineers and they had to build a distributed computational infrastructure. But then we got Hadoop, thank you. And that meant at that point, you know, maybe you had to hire a couple engineers and they had to install and maintain and configure your Hadoop cluster, which was still a ton of work, but it was affordable for people who had the time, energy, and high value problem worth doing it. And then these days, you can go to a command line and you can spin up a cluster with one command. And so, this kind of computation has become a commodity. It is something you can build on without having to reinvent and without necessarily having to even understand the details of like where in the world the machines are that you're running your computation on, which is amazing. I spoke at a conference a couple years ago where it was a science journalism conference. It was designed to get young, diverse people interested in science. And after my talk, this young woman came up to me and she said, can I ask you a couple of algorithmic questions? And I said, yeah, of course. What are you working on? And she's like, well, you know, I took my allowance and I took my DNA from 23andMe and I'm trying to find patterns in it. And this is a high school student. Maybe she's here today. That blew my mind. This is now a commodity. And sometimes things become commodities and then they become not commodities. So there was a company several years ago called Face.com, which did some really beautiful face recognition before this was a commodity in open source. And then they were acquired by Facebook, and that API was shut down. And so a lot of people who had built on that technology had to find another way. And eventually the open source community did catch up. And if you look at that website today, who knows what's going on there? And so you do have to be somewhat careful when you provide that sort of commodity technology that you can still expect it to be around in a little while. And the last thing that makes an idea really interesting is that new data might be available that makes it possible to address that idea. And so I have Wikipedia up here for two reasons. It is the dirty secret of data science. Every language processing algorithm is trained on Wikipedia data. It might be a little dramatic to say that, but it's essentially a core resource that has allowed for a lot of the cool stuff we see today. And it's also a reason why so many of these products are so much better in English than they are in other languages. So it's a little bit of cultural hegemony that we are inheriting from our data source, which is a super interesting thing to think about when you think about the end goal of these products. And there are problems we can't address because data isn't available. And the other side of this is that sometimes data is available but not useful. And so this is a project from ProPublica, which was super awesome, where they took the open surgeon success data from Medicare, and they made it really easy to visualize. So if anyone is having a very serious procedure on their list, you can go look up your doctor's success rate. It's a very important thing to know. But it's a great tool in the step to making data something that now other people can build on and enhance. And that's it. So we look for things that meet all of those criteria. We usually start the process by having a ton of coffee, reading a lot of science fiction, looking at the internet, and then coming up with terrible ideas, and eventually go through that process to sort of refine them into something interesting. And the idea is to have a series of things that get people excited about what they can build tomorrow. And we also give advice on how to actually get there from where you are today. And here are a couple of examples. We did a project on natural language generation, which is taking structured data and generating narrative. We have all the little books letterpressed in Brooklyn by like real hipsters, which is super cool. And we built this prototype which generates real estate ads. And so you give it your structured data and it tells you what the ad text should be. It generates that. So you know, like the sun-filled apartment will be your family's new home. And we chose this domain for a bunch of reasons. We didn't see anyone else who had already done real estate advertisements. There are lots of interesting products in the market around financial news reporting and sports. We also tried this on restaurant reviews, but couldn't think of a non-evil thing to do with that. Generating artificial reviews is not a good place to be. And we also learned a lot from this data set. So we learned things like if somebody describes the house as cozy in the ad, it is 400 square feet smaller than the average. And if they describe, it gets better, because if they describe it as grand or large or big or basically anything that means big, it is at the average or slightly below. So I think we've uncovered sort of a bias of real estate agents. So if they are thinking about the size, if they are talking about the size, it is a small property. So keep that in mind in your house hunting. We combine our papers and prototypes with being like nerd friends, and we end up helping people build products. And we look at people's work in a broad set of industries, and so I also wanted to share this from Siobhan Zillis, who's a venture capitalist at Brooklyn Beta, where she made this, it's kind of hard to see, but if you Google it, you can zoom in, this wonderful landscape of machine intelligence companies in different industries. And if you think about it from a computer science perspective, you can see how the same capabilities are manifesting in different products in different industries, and it's really great. We've done another project on probabilistic methods for real-time stream data. which is super fun. That is basically building computationally and memory constrained models from learning from streams of data. That is going from a metaphor of, I have a set of data, I'm gonna iterate through it as many times as I like to get to my answer, to data is arriving. I can look at each data point one time and make my calculation off of it as it comes in, and that's all I get. We looked at deep learning for image analysis, and I wanted to say, this was the first perceptron, and it blew my mind when I found out it was actually hardware. This is from Rosenblatt at the Cornell Aeronautics Lab, and all of those wires are like, this is a perceptron. The weights in the perceptron were potentiometers, which were tuned with motors. And so if you've looked at neural networks at all, you're probably much more used to something like this. And I had also assumed it was just math that we sort of visualized in this way. It was actually hardware to start with. And so I actually tried to put together my own little hardware perceptron, and it sort of worked. And I'm told this is really embarrassing to share, but I'm pretty proud of it anyway. And this is the technology, right? This one has Jennifer Lawrence and sort of dogs in it, so I feel like it's a winning picture. This is Google's deep dream applied to this photo of Jennifer Lawrence. That is the technology that led to this capability. And this is where you use the neural networks to take an image and bias it towards whatever the neural network is sort of trying to recognize in that image. And this is what you end up with, lots of things that are features, like, well, I'm not gonna go too deeply into this, but it's totally worth looking at the project. And we built a cute little prototype, it's called Pictograph, and you can auth in with your Instagram account, and it gives you a visualization of what you like to take pictures of by analyzing the contents of your photos. I already knew I had troublesome hair, because whenever I take a selfie, it tells me it's a wig. That's okay. It also thinks that any of my New York City subway photos are correctional institutions because, and there is a technical reason for that, but it is because we had no subway photos in the training data set. And so prison is the closest thing to the New York City subway. But again, even these errors teach us something about how the technology is working. And we have a more advanced version of this as well, where you can get a page of all the cats on that came from Instagram that are in our photo data set, which is kind of fun. And I want to say a couple words about where this is going, because I think there are two really interesting questions in the field today, and neither of them are really pure mathematical or technical questions. The first one is, how do we build products that are ethical around data that itself might not be ethical? And this is something that practitioners are really working hard to understand, and it's part of a larger conversation. And the second thing is, how do we think about the UI and the interfaces for people interacting with machine intelligence algorithms where we don't necessarily know what their capabilities are until they exist, and we don't know how they're going to respond to edge cases? And like my example of being a wig, or you know, my photos in the subway becoming a prison, you know, these are things that are, they are really funny errors, but if we start to integrate these things into our lives, we have to understand what the impact of those errors might be. And there are a lot of things that are on the horizon. I think that I've talked about my company as just one example of what is essentially a hack. It is an organization we're constructing in between different communities to fulfill a need. It's been a lot of fun so far. We have 8 people on the team, and it's going pretty well. We're having a good time. But I think there are other areas where this form of applied research could also happen. And there are lots of gaps in our current landscape of technology, of companies, of products, lots of things that have yet to be invented. And those are the things that I'm really excited about. And those are the things that sort of like keep us up at night. And we're launching a space program. I'm serious, we wrote a grant. It's probably not gonna go anywhere, but that was fun. I wanna end my talk by saying thank you to a lot of people for a lot of things. And also for saying, for those of you in the audience who are here, you know, you're at the beginning of your career and you're sort of thinking about where you might end up. My first Grace Hopper was 2002, and I was a shy and quiet student who mostly hid in the back of every talk and didn't dare ask a question. But it was wonderful to be in a room with so many people, so many of whom are here today, that has had a huge effect on my career going forward. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you to everyone who helped with this talk and told me I would survive it. And it is really wonderful to hear and to take the opportunity to have a wonderful conference to talk to as many people as you can, even if you feel shy, it will be okay. And to just really think thoughtfully about what we are going to build, hopefully, together. Because if you take anything away from this talk, I would really like it to be one thing, and that's careers in technology are hard to plan because we don't know what our field is going to look like in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, certainly not in 20 years. And so rather than saying, I want to get there when I grow up someday, I think it's much more helpful to say, I want to head in this direction, and this direction makes the world I want to live in. So, thank you.